It's a Sunday afternoon, and thank you for taking the time and joining this important webinar on the practical use of teleconsultations during this lockdown and even afterwards. So I'm sure it will be a very useful medium that you will find that is here, has been accepted by the Board of Governors and is here to stay. So I know all of you are going through webinar fatigue, so we are going to try to keep this brief. We have a good panel of experts today, so they're going to give you very useful practical advice. So I'm sure it'll be time well spent. Okay, we'll get started. This is our agenda for the 1 hour going forward from now. We have Dr. Jayanth Navrange. He heads the medico-legal cell in IMA Pune, and he will be covering new regulations and the financial aspects of teleconsultations, which are very useful topics. Next we have Dr. Manish Matswe, who is also a medico-legal expert advising many years now. He will cover the medico-legal safety aspects of teleconsultations. Next we have Dr. Dilip Walke, a prominent figure in Pune, has been helping people with medico-legal advice. After Dr. Dilip Walke, we have Dr. Aarti Nimkar, who is the president of IMA Pune, and she will share her views on teleconsultation during the COVID-19 lockdown and afterwards. And then we have a very interesting interview with Dr. Girija Wagh and Dr. Nachiket Kulkarni, who have been using teleconsultation in their practice for quite some time now, and they have very, very useful practical advice for all of us to use the platform. We'll follow this discussion with an interview with the DRPRAX demo, which is our platform. And then we have concluding remarks from Dr. Navrange, followed by a Q&A session in case you have any additional questions regarding teleconsultations or the DRPRAX platform. So we'll get started now. I hope everybody's ready.
I'm so sorry that it got disconnected. It's the technical hitch or hiccup, you can say. Particularly after the 2018 Bombay High Court decision regarding telecommunication, telemedicine practice by the medical practitioner, which was quite detrimental to the basic theme of spreading this telemedicine concept, teleconsultation practice in the medical field. In IMA Pune was the first one to come out with a clear guideline that what are the limitations of telemedicine and what are the real uses. In fact, can you all hear me and can you see me? So Government of India, right from this new government came in the power in 2014, has been promoting the use of telemedicine, telecommunication in the field of medical science to reach the masses which are scattered all throughout the country and to reach them effectively, scientifically and economically. However, because of certain decisions, judicial decisions coming out against telemedicine, there was a lot of apprehension in the minds of RMPs. However, because of this pandemic of COVID, it has become very necessary that social interactions and actual meeting and touching the people and coming to the clinics is...
Hello.
Yeah. Can I go ahead?
You go ahead, sir.
Okay. So the things have completely changed. So we had started this promotion of telemedicine and teleconsultation way back from September 2018, and also after the platform started coming in practice and coming to the doorsteps of the doctors, saying that this is going to be a long-term solution for various problems faced by the medical fraternity. So in Marathi we say ata tela raja manyata milaleli hai. That is because of Board of Governors, which are superseding the Medical Council of India regulations, has come out clearly on 25th of March through the official gazetted publication that telemedicine, teleconsultation is allowed. And they have given precisely the same limitations and same things where it is not allowed. So we will just see where it is not allowed. So rest of the all places it is allowed. So number one, it is allowed for all the patients staying in India, but not beyond India. So that is number one. Number two, it cannot be used to remotely control and give instructions to the person who is operating somewhere else or doing any invasive procedures. So with these two limitations, for everywhere else it is allowed. In short, it is allowed for the first consultation, it is allowed for the follow-up, it is also allowed for subsequent emergency situations. All these details will be told to you by Dr. Manish in a subsequent talk. So this is the legality is there. One more thing, which Maharashtra Medical Council came out with a notification 2 days prior to this MCI notification. Over there, they have mentioned that it is the same for, I mean, both the notifications are mentioning that it is the same format what a regular prescription will carry. So it is being incorporated in this particular app. Then confidentiality is to be maintained to the best of the limits. And in case the confidentiality is breached beyond your control due to some technical lapses or because of the problems beyond human control, then these doctors will be indemnified. So no action will remain. So these are some of the important notifications which have come as changes and amendments in the rules of MCI, which will be in detail covered subsequently. The second point was how far it is useful, extremely useful. What are the limitations which I already mentioned, that it cannot take the golden standard of in-person examination, but it is next best to that. And number three, what about the finances? The financial aspect is that every teleconsultation being a regular consultation, there is accountability, there is liability, same as in-person consultation. So therefore, you can easily charge. You take your regular fees, or even sometimes I would say you can charge a little more, considering the patient is going to save on his transportation. But that is up to you. This particular app does not restrict you from saying that this will be my fee. And in short, you can collect your fees in advance before you ultimately deliver your advice or deliver the prescription. The prescription format is exactly the same way as notified by MCI. So with this, these are my opening remarks. Certain medications are not allowed. These are Schedule X drugs, narcotic drugs, psychotropic drugs, not for teleprescription. So these three things, confidentiality, where it is going to be effective, what are the limitations, what is the disclaimer, and use your professional judgment to make it very successful. So professional judgment is the baseline of all the teleconsultation, has been highlighted time and again by MCI and MMC both. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Basically, what I'm going to present today at this moment of time for the next 3 to 5 minutes, and I think this is the crux of the today's meeting, and the crux is about how is it that we should choose an ideal private platform provider. There are many private platform providers in the market, so what we need to know about which is the most ideal one to choose. So let's go ahead with that. The agenda for the next maybe 3 to 5 minutes goes like this. Number one, can we not continue to use our mobile or WhatsApp that we have been using for so long? I mean, we have been giving our advices on the WhatsApp or on a mobile. Do we really need a private platform provider? So that's the question number one that we have to address. Is it not possible that we'll continue to use our mobiles and continue to use our WhatsApp for the teleconsultation that we used to do for so many years? The second question is, what do the MCI guidelines expect from the private platform service providers? So what is the minimum that is needed by the private platform to be given to us? The third question is, what kind of service should we as doctors insist from them? So the MCI might say that you give this service, but what is it that we need from them? So that we must know. And thirdly and fourthly, how to ensure that we are getting monetized for our efforts and increase our OPD cash. Hello? Hello, am I audible? Hello?
Yeah, Dilip, you are very
much audible.
Right. I will neglect whatever are the disturbances that are coming because there are some people who are not.
We need to mute all. Vinita, please mute everyone.
Okay, I'll continue.
Yes, sir, we are muting everyone.
Okay, so the first question that I was posing is, why do we need a private platform provider? The first thing why we need them is only a private platform provider can provide us a payment gateway to create some situation so that we can monetize ourselves. Because Otherwise, what we do on telephone or what we do on WhatsApp, we have got no way to monetize ourselves. Secondly, the prescriptions that Navrange sir just told us, that the prescription has to be as per the templates, especially in Maharashtra Medical Council on their website, we have a proper template of prescription. If we are giving any prescription on a WhatsApp or on telephone, there is no way that we can give it in form of a proper template where our signature will be there and where our stamp will be there. So that only can be provided by the private platform provider. Then the private platform provider can give a situation, can give us the technology so that all the data can be stored on the cloud. And if you go through the guidelines that have come, the guidelines say that it is mandatory for us to keep the log of all the teleconsultation. It is mandatory for us to keep a record of all the prescriptions you have given, and it is mandatory for us to keep the patient record. So which means whenever we are doing it on one-to-one basis on a telephone or a WhatsApp, we will not be able to do that. The private platform providers will do it. And lastly, privacy maintenance, because if we are using a social media like a WhatsApp, then that is not leak proof. And the private providers can give us the privacy maintenance, which is very vital and which is what the guidelines are forcing us to take care of. So what does the Board of Governor of MCI expects from these private platform providers? The basically only 4-5 things. They are not asking for much from the private platform provider. Number one, they want them to ensure that the name, the qualification as per the IMC Act 1956 and the registration number and contact details of RMP should be there on the platform. Number one. Number two, they say if there is any non-compliance from the registered medical practitioner, then it has to be reported to the Board of Governors. Number three, they say they have to avoid all artificial intelligence machines that many of the platforms use to counsel the patient. So that artificial intelligence counseling the patients is out. And fourthly, they have to ensure a mechanism for redressal of grievances of the customer. So itna hi, they want only this much from the private platform providers. But what is it that we should ask? So this is what myself, Dr. Navrange and Dr. Manish Matsve have been associated with DR Prax. And we have been asking this from DR Prax, and that's the reason why it has become such a robust kind of a platform that it is today. So number one, what we said that it is not only it should be an Android based, but it should be an iPhone based mobile application with website support also. It cannot be only a mobile application. Number two, they should not be using any social media, so there will be no privacy issues. Number three, they should have support for audio, video, chats, and health document exchange. That is the health record of the patient that can be exchanged and stored on the cloud. I have written video in red here because at this moment of time, we have to accept that DR Prax does not have the option of doing video consultation, but Vinita will tell us about it very soon. I think the timeline is almost there and we will be able to start our video consultation also on DR Prax. It will not be very far. It will be in few days, not even weeks. So even that is going to start up. Fourthly, it should not be seen to be soliciting practice for us. I mean, it should not be a platform on which you're seen to be soliciting practice for yourself, because that is considered to be non-ethical as per the MCI Code of Ethics. And that has been reiterated in the guideline document that you should not be soliciting practice. Lastly, it should be the data that is there, whatever chat that has happened between us and the patient and whatever prescription we have given, it should be in an encrypted data storage form. It should be accessible for decoding only to the RMP and only to the patient. And if at all at the platform end somebody can decode it, then there has to be a proper non-disclosure agreement with them, so that other private document that is there between us and the patient should not be tampered and should not be available for anybody to see. So that is one thing that is very important for this private platform provider, which we have taken care when it comes to DR Prax. More things are, the platform should confirm doctor's photo ID and the patient's photo ID. At this moment of time, we have not been doing it, but very soon Dr. Prax is going to insist on doctor's photo ID so that the whosoever is registering it as a doctor, we should be sure that he is the person who is a doctor and he is an RMP and his registration number should be there. Same should be with the portal, patient's identity also. There should be space on the cloud for storage of the patient's health record. So all this should be there. The platform should provide that. And there should be medical legal safety for doctors with clear disclaimers and consent or even the first login. I mean, immediately, as no sooner than the patient logs in with this for the first time, the patient has signed all the disclaimers. So the guidelines might say that if the patient has initiated the teleconsultation, we don't need any consent. The consent is implied. But here we have taken care for every interaction. The patient has already given you consents and all the disclaimers have been sent to the patient even before she or he started consultation. The prescription should be available with a ready-made template, which DR Prax has taken care of. It is as per the MMC website, with provision for doctor's signature and stamp. The DR Prax app gives you a provision that the stamp is already there, your stamp with your registration number, and on the Android phone, you can actually sign, and then the patient can take a printout of that. That will be a very ideal prescription, which any chemist will be able to honor. And we insisted on some add-ons also when it comes to DR Prax. Number one, medico-legal advice on click of a button, because Dr. Navrange is online with us, Dr. Manish is online with us, myself is already there, and others, Dr. Gitendra Sharma, Dr. Hitesh Bhatt, Dr. M.C. Patel, and there are many more. I mean, Advocate Amit Karkhanis, Advocate Milind Sarunke, all these people have shown interest in joining our platform. So anybody wanting any advice, you can get connected with any one of them. Instead of giving them a call, you can get connected with them, and even they will be monetized for whatever advice they have given. So this advice will be there on the app itself. Technical support to send patient information booklet about different procedures and surgeries. Now, suppose tomorrow you're doing a hysterectomy, you should be able to send an information booklet, which Foxy is now designing. In a month or two, maybe we'll come out with patient information booklets for every procedure and for every surgery that we are doing. So this can be sent to the patient, say about 24, 48 hours before the surgery. And patient can also give you an e-consent for the surgery and procedure. Apart from a actual consent when the patient comes to the hospital, we can also take an e-consent. So this issue of our consent being an informed consent is taken care of, because we will be able to prove in the court of law that the information document was indeed sent to the patient not 24 but 48 hours even before the surgery. So that is one thing that we wanted this app to provide, and their provision is there for that. There should be easy access to guidelines drafted by different society, like an RCOG guideline, like a FOXI guideline, DCPR guideline. The doctor should be able to access that, and the patient should be able to access all that has been given as patient information booklets by RCOG, by FOXI, and by any other society or organization. There should also be a practice management solution for managing in-person OPD too. I mean, it should not be just an app for a teleconsultation. It should go beyond that, and it should help us to manage our practice in-person OPD also. So we have taken care of that too. I mean, it can easily be used as a practice management solution for your OPD patient, where you can have like your routine softwares. It can be there on the website, and you can do all your OPD consultations and take a printout of your consultation and store your record on the cloud forever. So this app is not only an app for teleconsultation, but we have seen to it, because myself, Dr. Navrange, and Dr. Manish Masve has been involved in this app right from the beginning. We have seen to it that this app is medico-legally compliant also. Another most important requirement is that this app has got a secure payment gateway to monetize our chats, our video calls, and our prescription. So no sooner than we do a chat, or no sooner than we give a prescription, that is seen by the patient in a blurred form. And the platform tells them that for this prescription, you need to pay so many rupees. And only when they pay that much amount, that the prescription is seen by them. So all this embarrassing thing of asking for the chat or for the video call or the prescription is taken care of by the platform providers, and we are not supposed to do any of that thing. So that is one important thing. Now, what difference will it make for cash flow in the practice? Why is it that we say that whatever consultation that we have been doing all these years on the telephone or on WhatsApp needs to be now?
Visible, sir. Can you repeat? Can you once again share your screen?
Once again, share the screen. Okay.
Yeah, I think your video is not visible again.
But from which slide was I not visible?
Just a couple of minutes.
No, video is seen. Vinita, video is seen. Video is seen. Not a problem. There's some.
That is because somebody, Dinesh Bokare, who is now presenting.
Yeah. So. Yeah,
yes, so if you can just represent your slides.
But how can I, when he is presenting, how can I?
No, so you actually when somebody new joins. So when somebody new joins, they join as a presenter, and that is why this problem.
Yeah, sir. Now it's, I think you have to join present again, sir. I think Siddhi Clinic took over. If you have to present again.
But the Siddhi Clinic, I have to resume presenting.
Sorry about this. I think next time share we will now. Do it on some other platform, Google Hangout.
Now yes, can you see my screen?
We were able to see till the last slide, no problem.
Okay, so the last thing that I wanted to stress upon was the important thing of secure payment gateway to monetize the chats, the video calls or the prescriptions. Supposing if I saw the patient today and after 2 days the patient calls me for something, and I want to do charge that patient say 300 rupees or so 500 rupees. All that I can give the chat, I can generate the prescription which will be seen by the patient there in a blurred form, and unless the payment is made, they will not see the prescription in a proper form which can be printable from their side. So all this embarrassment of asking for money for our chat, for our prescription is done by the company and not by us. So all that we have to do is continue your chat, and then the platform will ask you whether you want to charge for it. You just say yes, and whatever amount you want to charge, and then message goes to the patient through the platform and not through you. So that's how it makes it easy for us to charge for every chat, for every video call, and for every prescription that we are generating. And there is an option for charging zero also. Supposing today you saw the patient in the morning, and in the evening she is doing some teleconsultation with you, and you feel that now that she has already paid in the morning, I should not be charging anything now. I have an option of charging from zero to whatever amount that I want to charge for that particular chat or for that particular prescription. The moment I click on charge whatever amount, then that particular chat or the prescription is seen in a blurred form from the patient side. Only when they make the payment will it be seen. So now, why is it that I am insisting that we should be charging for our OPD practice on follow-up, which we do on teleconsultation or on telephone? Because it makes a difference in the cash flow of our practice. And I can only share with you the statistic of my practice, because I have not tried to do it with others' practice. What I know is 60% of times my OPD is just a follow-up OPD, wherein I have already done the history taking, I have already done the examination of the patient a reasonable time prior to the teleconsultation. But 60% of my time, prior to the in-person consultation, but 60% time it is just a follow-up for change in dose, for taking appointment for a surgery, for some add-on small problems wherein I have to just give a crocin or just give an antacid or things like that. So it is just a simple follow-up OPD. 10 to 20% times for all these years, I have been doing this follow-up on telephone, on WhatsApp, free of charge. So my loss of income due to this free follow-up on telephone or WhatsApp is to the tune of 10 to 15% of my OPD income. So my question is, why should we lose? Forget about the COVID year, forget about the need for doing teleconsultation during this COVID period. Even later on, why should we lose the 10 to 15% of the OPD income which we were losing because we were giving free advices on the telephone or WhatsApp? So to increase our OPD cash flow by 10 to 15%, not much is required at all for us to do. All that you have to do is be online on just download DR Prax, convince all your patients to do the consultation on the DR Prax app. And all you have to do is whatever you have been doing, whatever telephonic consultation you were giving all these years, whatever WhatsApp consultation you were doing all these years, only do it through DR Prax and keep on getting monetized for you, monetized for it. And I can assure you, your OPD income will increase easily by 10 to 15%. But now if you want to increase your OPD cash flow by 25%, then you have to be a little bit innovative like Girija and Nachiket. And Vinita is going to take a little interview of Girija and Nachiket afterwards. And then what is going to happen is you will get all the... what they have done is they have explored new avenues of for telephonic consultation. So if they can do it, then we can also do it in our practice. So if Girija can reach up to a stage where she is earning 25% extra of what she would have earned from her OPD flow, or Nachiket is doing the same, then I think everybody sitting here should be able to do that. So that is what attracted me towards this. So to conclude, post-COVID era is that of innovative practice. Because now, post-COVID, there is going to be innovation in everywhere, in healthcare, in industry, in the hotel industry, in the gyms, everywhere there is going to be innovation. So we should not be left out. We have to be innovative also. There is a scope of for a lot of innovation in telemedicine also. So all that you have to do is, whatever new thing you want, you just ask for it. And I can assure you, I am very confident about the technical team of DR Prax. They will definitely solve your provide a solution to whatever innovation that you want to do on the telemedicine platform, and that will be done. I thank you very much for a patient listening, and I think I'll stop my presentation part of it so that we can take it forward.
Thank you, Dr. Balaji.
Thank you, sir. Vinita, can you put me on now?
Yes, sir. You can go ahead and you can present now.
So I'll present now.
And share your screen.
Entire screen. That's what I'm doing.
We can see your screen.
You can see my slides now?
Yes, we can see them. Please go ahead.
Okay. All right.
Can you put them on full screen, sir?
Yeah. Okay now?
Yes.
Okay. So I pray to Lord Ganesha to sail me through this presentation. Very good evening to everyone on a Sunday evening. I hope your cup of tea is by this time over. And let us discuss something about the good, the bad and the ugly. So when the patient and the doctor meet on the phone, three different things, they are bound to have some medico-legal issues, medico-legal aspects. And medico-legal issues were not there, especially when Hanumana was sent to get Sanjeevani Bhuti. Otherwise, he would have called from there and asked, and he was not required to carry an entire mountain. So there were a lot of advantages which we had in our mind. We were doing it all the time for our patients until courts sort of interfered and thought that this is not right. So we have a lot of cases, till almost 2018-19, which said that, for example, this is one case from Jharkhand State Commission, wherein a patient was admitted with acute abdomen. The senior doctor told the junior doctor to give a painkiller on phone, and the patient died of acute pancreatitis. Now, the doctor was held negligent because the treatment was given on phone without examining the patient, and a compensation of 10 lakh of rupees was given. Again, if you see one more case from Karnataka State Commission, a psychiatric patient who had cardiac disease. Now, this history was completely missed on the phone, and injection Serenase was prescribed. The patient died. Again, the doctor was held negligent. Treatment was given on phone without examination of patient. A compensation of 3 lakh of rupees was given. And then this thing happened with one of our own members who attended a conference in Pune. And somehow the High Court Mumbai did not consider the telephonic conversation as or telephonic treatment as an opt one, as an apt one. But there were multiple issues in this case. So it was not only telephone. The Mumbai judgment was, not quoted properly. So there were a lot of different issues. But all in all, there are medico-legal concerns when we discuss about telecommunication. So who would do it? To whom it can be given? What are the medicines that can be prescribed? how is the prescription generated, what kind of consent is needed, what kind of records and compliance are need to be kept, what are the adverse effects and complications of medicines if they arise, then whose liability, how much liable is the doctor for issues arising out of it, or if a patient is dissatisfied with the treatment, and what happens in emergency. So there are a lot of issues. Let us see some of the concerns which are put to rest because of this notification which came out on 25th of March 2020. Now, this is in addition to Board of Governors, this is in addition to our conduct, professional conduct, etiquette and ethics regulations 2002, which Navrange sir also mentioned during his talk. Now, I am going to put 2-3 slides repeatedly. So I want all our listeners to take a photograph of these slides because this is exactly, am I audible, sir? Hello?
Yes, very much audible.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Manish, you're audible.
Yes, sir. So I'm going to put 2-3 slides repeatedly for us, all of us to understand and take photographs because these are the most important slides from the entire presentation. Now, this Board of Governors, the notification which has come out, it has listed the drug in 3 categories. List O, these are antipyretics like paracetamol, cough supplements, cough lozenges, ORS packets, and certain medications which are issued by Government of India, like malaria control, chloroquine, so on and so forth. So please remember, List O, very important. This can be easily prescribed by any telecommunication method, either on phone or email or fax, so on and so forth. This is List O drugs. Then there is List A drugs. Now, these medicines are to be given only and only when there is a video mode of consultation. Now, this is very important because things like ointments, clotrimazole, ophthalmological drops, ear drops, ciprofloxacin, so on and so forth, these medicines from List A are to be given only when you do a video consultation. Follow-up medicines for chronic illnesses like refill medicine. So somebody is already taking that medicine. Now he wants a refill. That is also under List A. Now List B medicines are the ones which are only to be given as chronic medications to patients who are there and who come for a follow-up consultation. And these are called add-on medicines. Now List...
You are not audible, Manish.
Manish, you're not audible.
You're not audible, sir.
You need to unmute yourself, sir.
Manish, you are not audible since List B.
Manish, Vinita. Unmute yourself. Somebody has muted you.
Manish. Somebody muted him, actually.
No, actually, I think he muted himself, sir.
Okay.
No.
Yeah, now can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Go ahead, Manish.
No, you need to present.
Today's not my day, okay?
No. It's not that. Don't worry. It's a challenge because I think everybody, when they're joining, they're presenting themselves.
The guidelines
now
also
say you
can hit in the platform, hello? But the RMP is not responsible.
Hello?
Okay. Yes, sir. We can hear you. Continue.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you, Manish. Continue.
All right. So List O, List A and List B. And this is the kind of, so this is given in Annexure 1 in the guideline. This is Annexure 2, which is how the prescription is to be given. Now, if you see age, height, weight, diagnosis, provisional and final, if it is made, relevant points in the history, investigations, drugs, special instructions, RMP signature and stamp. So I'm going to put these 2-3 slides again and again because we have to compulsorily follow it as per guidelines. So now the question is, who can use telecommunication? A registered medical practitioner can use. For now, anybody can use. But soon, maybe after this COVID pandemic is over, the Board of Governors are going to come out with a guideline, a sort of examination or a test, which everybody has to give online. And after whoever has given this test and whoever has got the certification will only be able to practice telemedicine. But as on today, yes, everybody, whoever is a RMP. Now, an RMP is a person whose name is registered in the state registered. So automatically, I don't think Ayurvedic people or homeopathy people are, you know, in any way can do this telemedicine. So it is only for allopathic people. Now, which fora can be used? As I said, the fora which can be used are video fora. Am I audible? Vinita, am I audible?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Which fora you can use? There are video fora like telemedicine app, video chats, audio fora like phones, text-based telemedicine, general messaging, and email and fax. So all these come under telemedicine. Now, this point is extremely important. Now, use of digital technology to conduct surgical or invasive procedure remotely is completely excluded. So you cannot send a video to somebody, or you cannot, you know, show a video and somebody seeing a video and then doing that surgery. Very important point is they do not provide consultations outside the jurisdiction of India. So it is only meant to be within the, you know, confines of our own country. And obviously, it cannot be used to you know, give education to healthcare workers. So this is something which we have to completely know. Now, they have given very clearly telecommunication or telemedicine used for four categories: patient to RMP, caregiver, that is sister to RMP, RMP to RMP, and health worker to RMP, wherein we are mostly discussing patient to RMP and RMP to RMP. Now, the guidelines very clearly say the elements which are to be used in telemedicine consultation. I don't want to go into details. I just will highlight the part which is medico-legally important for us. It is very important to have clear identity of the patient and of the doctor. So no anonymous calls can be made. It is very important that the patient understands the name of RMP, the RMP's credentials, and the RMP's state registration number. It is also very important for the RMP to understand the patient's age, the patient's name and address. Now, if a minor is consulting, then there has to be an adult present with the minor whose identity also needs to be ascertained. What about the consent? Now, the consent, there are two things here. If the patient gives a call to an RMP, then the consent is an implied consent. But if a RMP gives a call to a healthcare worker, caregiver, or a patient, then it has to be an explicit written consent, which has to be sent by the patient either as email, text, or audio video message. Now, all these consents, the RMP has to keep a record either as a soft copy or print and hard copy as per the MCI guidelines. What is the legal liability of RMP? RMP shall see that the prescribed medicines are in the best interest of patient, and whatever medicines the RMP is prescribing, his or her liability is complete. So if I say tomorrow that I am prescribing something on telemedicine and my liability reduces because I have not seen the patient, cannot be a defense. And prescribing medicines without appropriate diagnosis is a professional misconduct. So be very aware of what you are prescribing, what you are telling the patient, so on and so forth. Again, this is what I was trying to tell you. There are list O, list A, and list B drugs. There are some prohibited drugs. So schedule X drugs, drugs which come under narcotic and psychotropic substances, all those cannot be used through telemedicine. List O group of drugs, if you remember, where the drugs which had antacids, cough syrups, antipyretics, those can be used by any mode of consultation, video, audio, or text, either first consultation or follow-up. Group A drugs, where the drugs which I told you are only to be used with video consultation, most of the ointments, eye drops, ear drops, either for first or follow-up consultation, come in this category. Category B drugs are the ones wherein you are adding on a drug for hypertension or diabetes, where already the drugs are, the patient is taking those drugs, and they are only for follow-up. So this important things, the category of drugs and what mode of consultation and what type of consultation is needed to prescribe these drugs is extremely important. Now, what is misconduct? When are we liable, or as an RMP who's using telemedicine is liable for misconduct? RMP insisting on telemedicine when the patient is willing to travel. So if the patient is saying, okay, I can come to your OPD or hospital, and you are insisting on telemedicine, is a misconduct. RMP is misusing patients' images or data, especially sensitive images, if they are putting on different, you know, fora. So herein, it is very important. Again, I keep on telling my friends who are doing ultrasound that please take patient's consent before sending plates or using video images for laparoscopy. RMPs prescribe medicines from the specific restricted list. Friends, that is the reason why I showed you the list O, list A, and list B. and the different modes of how to prescribe those lists, and I'm going to put that again in another slide. RMPs who solicit patients through advertisements or inducements, all this come under misconduct, and as per Indian Medical Council Act, they will be punished. What are the records? The records are similar. You have to keep a log or record of telemedicine interaction, all patients' records, reports, documents, images, diagnostics, so on and so forth, and all the prescription records have to be kept properly as per the MCI guidelines. Yes, you can charge your fees for telemedicine. Dr. Valke sir has already, you know, deliberated on this. It will be appropriate fee, and you have to generate a receipt or invoice for the fee charge for providing telemedicine based consultation. Now, there are first consultation and follow-up consultation. So this is something which we have to understand and know what it is, because there are certain drugs which can be given for first consultation and certain drugs which can be given only for follow-up consultation. So first consultation is defined as a patient who's consulting the RMP either for the first time or he is consulting the RMP again, but within 6 months, not more than 6 months have elapsed, or if more than 6 months have elapsed with a different health condition. So please understand, this is the definition of first consultation. Now, what is to be done at first consultation is, again, because I am putting lot of stress on group O, group A and group B drugs. Group A drugs only through video consultation, group O drugs through audio, video or text, and group B only for follow-up patients. So if the patient has come for first consultation, you do patient identification and you have to take the consent. It is explicit if you have called, implied if the patient has called. You have to quickly assess and then decide whether this is okay to be treated, or health care counseling given, or any type of health education given through telemedicine. If that is the case, then you have to obtain maximum or complete patient information, history, investigation, reports, ask for additional information, so on and so forth. Now, herein also is an integral part that if you want to examine the patient can show a video and then send you the video and you can see the video, or you can ask a caregiver or another RMP to examine the patient through video consultation and then send you that video. Now, then comes the management part. So if management with health education, counseling and specific treatment, again, in case of teleconsultation on video, prescribe list A medicine. So list A medicines are only to be prescribed if the consultation is done on video. What is a follow-up consultation? A follow-up consultation, I think mostly people who are practicing medicine, diabetes, hypertension, and you know, so many other disorders, it is important for them. The patient is consulting with the RMP within 6 months of his or her previous in-person consultation. Important is, if it is more than 6 months, then the patient has to go and see the RMP in person. Telemedicine cannot be used. Follow-up can be in situation of chronic diseases, as I told you, where face-to-face consultation is not necessary. Now, what is to be done for follow-up? Again, either video, audio or text. Now, follow-up consultation, you can give category O drugs, category A drugs with video, and category B drugs can be given to these kind of patients. The flowchart is very much there in the guidelines, so I'm not, you know, going through it completely. But can you hear me? My voice is coming.
Yes, yes, continue. Yes.
Yeah, Manish, we can hear you.
Yeah. Okay.
थोड़ा so, जरा ऊपर संपो करन, meeting is only for an hour.
Yeah, okay. Okay. Last 3-4 slides. Done. So I'm running through this. Now, what happens in an emergency situation? Now, important for RMP to understand that in case of emergency situation, advice, first aid, counseling, and facilitate referral. So, important part of the telecommunication is to refer the patient to the nearest hospital or healthcare facility in case of emergency situations. List O drugs, list A drugs, list B drugs, and the prescription. This I am putting for the second time because this is most important part. And this, so list O drugs, audio, video, or text, list A only by video, and list B drugs can be given only to follow-up patients. Few 3-4 question answer scenarios. In case of an emergency, can I call the RMP for immediate advice? Yes, you may call, but the RMP may refuse. Now, this is the difference between telemedicine and a person coming to us as an emergency. As an emergency, we have to manage the patient, but in telemedicine, you can insist that the patient can go to a nearest health facility and refuse telecommunication. Can an RMP refuse or discontinue? Yes, RMP can refuse or discontinue a patient, and the same liberty is provided to the patient also. If I am for a follow-up case, for example, diabetes, how long can I continue to request a refill medicine? Maximum period of 6 months, I told you. After this period, an in-person consultation is mandatory. Do I need to print a prescription? No, e-prescription is good enough. I have already given you the outline, and you can store it as a soft copy or take a print. You can send it to the pharmacist. The pharmacist can, you know, see the prescription and provide adequate medicines. This is most important question. Can I prescribe antibiotics on teleconsultation? Now, the guidelines say that antibiotics can be prescribed by RMP, but only if that person is strongly convinced about the same. Now, as in all scenarios, the RMP is responsible for his or her prescription. So whatever you prescribe, if you see category O, category A and category B drug, the only antibiotics which are mentioned there are topical antibiotics or antibiotics given to the ear and to the eye. So please be, really convinced to give them. Again, this is very important questions. Can I prescribe injectable medicines on teleconsultation? Now, the guidelines say an RMP can prescribe injectable medicines only when another RMP is giving those medicines or a healthcare worker is administering. So RMP must be confident about the facility and the technical expertise. Exceptions being what medicines are already going on, like insulin, low molecular weight, heparin, etc. So this therein comes the issue of RMP to RMP telecommunication. Other than the requisitions which we send to the pathologist or the sonologist to get investigations done. So medico-legal concerns, who can do it? An RMP can do it. A patient calls, it's an implied consent. What medicines? Category O, category A and category B drugs. Category O can be given over video, audio or text. Category A, only video. Category B, only for follow-up. How? Prescription as given in Annexure 2. Consent is an implied consent when the patient calls. If you have called, then explicit consent has to be taken. Records on and compliance have to be maintained as per in-house consultation. Adverse effects and complications, you have to be very sure about what you are prescribing, because you are liable if something goes wrong. Liability of a doctor in emergency or other situations is 100% there. Please note about the misconduct and in which situations the misconduct can be put against you for telecommunication. Thank you so much. I think if there are any questions, we can take that will be much better. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Yes, ma'am. Can you cover? The role of IMA in telemedicine.
Okay. Everything is covered by the Manish. Dilip and Dr. Navrange sir, what is the advantages, disadvantages, and what precautions we have to take, and which drugs we have to prescribe, and in what situation they should be prescribed. We all gone through that. Only I am going to talk about the part of the IMA. For this telemedicine. The IMA is very much proactive for this telemedicine, because last year when Dr. Varke has asked Dr. Navrange about the telemedicine and teleconsultation in the April, in the March, that time Dr. Navrange gave the answer that we can do the telemedicine and teleconsultation because it is the need of this situation and need of this era.
Madam, so, I'll just interview in here. That the first line should be 20th March 2019.
20th March. Now this.
This is last year, 2019.
That's correct. Letter.
Anyway, yeah. Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, and before that, we were not exactly allowed to use the telemedicine, because in Martin D'Souza and Mohammed Isaac case in 2009, the guidelines were that. Supreme Court given is the guideline that avoid telemedicine consultation as far as possible, but it is not written that it is no absolutely banned. It is narova kunjarova. There were not absolute guidelines for the telemedicines. Now they have made the guidelines, and it is very good for the doctors and also for the patients. Those who are living in the remote areas and cannot travel for a long distances. And because of the travel expenses and medicine expenses, they cannot afford and cannot go for the consultation. For them, it is very good asset to give them the teleconsultation. And if in the in the emergency situations, we can advise them to go to the hospital, to go nearest consultant and expert in that field. So we can help the our consultants and also to the patients. And in this situation, disasters are like the pandemic. We can very much use this in a better way, that we can avoid the, we can maintain the distancing and give the consultation and medicine for the non-COVID or COVID patient and ask them to consult the specialist or go for the test and get the proper treatment. And we can avoid the communication of the our staff and co-workers with the infected patients. So it is very much helpful and very much important in this. Only professional judgment of the registered medical practitioners should be guiding the principle for all the telemedicine consultations. Then we have to decide which patient we have to do the telemedicine only, or we have to advise them to go to the consultant or visit the hospital. That is the criteria, and we have to take care of that and to avoid the all the medical legal litigation and avoid all the misconducts. Thank you very much, and for everything.
Thank you, Arti, very much, and I must put on record here the kind of help that I received from Dr. Nautangay, Dr. Padma Iyer, Dr. Sanjay Patil, and now from Dr. Arti Nimkar. When it comes to Pune IIMC support for teleconsultation, it is something that I must thank them for today, because it was just about a year back that they helped us in my DR practice, what it is today, the technical development of DR practice, because of the encouragement that we got from Pune IIMC. So I must put it on record for that. Now I request Dr. Vinita to take an interview of Dr. Girija and Dr. Nathiko.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Arti, and thank you for, you know, thanking the entire IIMC team. We are deeply indebted to them. They were pioneers in understanding the need even before the need of the hour came through because of the pandemic. So we wanted to ensure that we were medically legally compliant. So we worked extensively with Dr. Navarango from the legal cell to ensure that we covered all the terms, conditions, disclaimers, and notifications to the patient to ensure that we protect the doctors that were joining the platform. And they had, they were operating, or they were teleconsulting under a medico-legal cover. So deepest thank you to and gratitude to the IIMC Pune team, and thank you for being pioneers in this very important journey. Okay, I would like to now proceed to an interview with two eminent doctors in Pune, Dr. Girija Wag and Dr. Nachiket Kulkarni. These doctors again have been proactive. They have been using teleconsultation for over a year now, and we'd definitely like to hear from you. I would like to start and ask Dr. Girija Wag, can you talk a little bit about teleconsultation and how it has been useful to you in your practice, and what are your overall views of teleconsultation?
Okay, see, according, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are.
Hello, everybody. There are so many other voices coming in, but I think my voice is quite loud. I started off with this particular thing because first and foremost, I used to find that my patients find it extremely difficult to come to reach to us in time because of the traffic. And many a time when they used to come from a distance, they used to miss the appointment, or sometimes, you know, then we have to clamor for the time. And secondly, when I went and analyzed my follow-ups, as Dilip said in his presentation, most of them were follow-up time. Secondly, I deal with many infertility patients, especially, and also obstetric patients, and many PCOD and such kind of patients, which we can definitely deal with on an OPD basis, was what I identified. Secondly, many of my patients I found were quite educated, and today on the basis of, like, when we are talking of high-risk hospitals, when women are usually not very happy coming back from their homes and all, we found that doing home blood pressure monitoring, doing home sugar monitoring, because many of my cases are high-risk toxic patients, this helped tremendously for me. Now, as Manish mentioned, that there are a lot of strictures about, you know, writing certain things. What I felt was, if you are having a proper communication, which is not only cordial, but you suggest to the patient nicely that these are the things which are the limitations of this communication and these are the others, they are very happy to take it. So that was the reason why I actually went into this. Now, of late recently, the Cloud9 forum has also started for us a mechanism of video consultation. So what we have done now is we have cut down our OPD timings, which are face-to-face consultations, and we are more now on teleconsultations. And of course, we have gone through all the legalities as mentioned by Manish. And then within those only, we prescribe, give our prescriptions, give basically the advantage which I found was you can give them a lot of educative material. जो भी चीजें हम बोलते हैं विनीता आई मस्ट टेल यू दैट आई हैव रिकॉर्डेड सम ऑडियो क्लिप्स यू नो लाइक इफ दे हैव टू शेयर विद मी देयर डबल मार्कर टेस्ट देन आई जस्ट गिव सेंड देम दैट ऑडियो क्लिप सो द पेशेंट आई डोंट हैव टू डू इट रिपीटेडली अगेन एंड अगेन समटाइम्स आई हैव यू नो सो दैट इज एन एडवांटेज व्हिच आई फेल्ट वाज दैट यू इंक्रीज योर एक्सपेंस एंड रीच आउट टू पेशेंट इन लेस अमाउंट ऑफ टाइम and without
ma'am, that is an excellent example. So I would actually ask the same question to Dr. Nachiket Kulkarni. He has enough huge insights and he has a lot of practical knowledge on this as well. I would like to hear from him and on his views as well.
Hi everybody. About telemedicine, the basic start first is apart from legalities that we have understood, we need to understand that three forms of telemedicine have been put forth: video consultation, audio consultation, and text-based consultations. Going through the guidelines, we feel that as if video consultation is the most paramount and probably the only important way of communication. But that doesn't necessarily say so. Most of our patients that today we are going to probably connect with through telemedicine are going to be our own patients. We have to first hold our flock together and then try to be ready for patients who are going to walk in me. So for patients who are our own flock, or patients who are on our regular follow-up, they become category B medications. And those category B medications can be given through video, audio, or text-based consultations. I look forward to Dr. Manish Matsve if I am correct, really speaking. Now, the practicality of using video consultations is, though world over there are Zoom meetings, app meetings, all those occur correctly if there's a wired net. If the people are sitting on the PC, for us to be able to connect with our patients, we are going to connect through video apps on mobile. The cellular networks are not really that strong in India. If we require a continuous 4G communication to have 500 Kbps internet service to be able to have a streaming both ends, so patient being able to look at us, we being able to look at the patient, and the mobile does not offer such a high level of internet connectivity. That is why this disparity, also when you do a video consultation, it is even more imperative that a summary of the video consultation has to be mentioned in your electronic medical record. So you're going to talk with your patient and you're going to record what you're going to talk. That's what I think is going to be a problem with video. Second is audio. Now the audio consultations come up with the ease that it is not dependent on net. You can directly connect to the patients. That is true. But again, whatever happens in the audio consultation has to be recorded. Now, in either of two, if the patient has initiated the consultation, then the consent becomes implied. But there's a doubt out there, which I would look forward to Dr. Matsve to clear, is though the patient directly connects to us, we are sending the forum of trying to connect through audio or video. So in a way, it's the expert who is going to the patient to start the telemedicine consultation. Then again, the consent has to be very explicitly mentioned. A one-liner consent that are you ready to consult through this video call or are you ready to consult through this audio call is very important. We have to make ourselves a habit to be doing that. The text medical consultations, which I use most often, let it be Dr. Prax, let it be any other telemedicine communication platform, is I think in India the most easy and most viable option. People are well versed with WhatsApp. Dr. Prax and most of telemedicine, and specifically Dr. Prax, is as good as a Xerox copy of WhatsApp. the communication that the patient gets archived immediately. You are able to go back and log into what the patient has said 2 weeks back, what the patient has said a week back. You are able to even log and see, compare whatever qualitative or quantitative factors or variables the patient has to enter. For example, blood pressure last 4 weeks back was 150, 90. Today it is 180, 100. This ability to go back to the old data and connect and then review is only possible in text, not in audio or video, because they are all recorded and archived. Consenting becomes easy because if you have a template where you take a consent saying that you are ready to do a text-based consultation, you understand the inadequacies of doing such a consultation, and you confirm to give all histories, both comorbid or the present event related. A template once sent to the patient and the patient says yes becomes a complete consenting. So a text-based app gives you a better consenting format. A text-based app gives you a better interactive format because it requires the least net connectivity. And from a doctor's perspective, it gives us a chance to go back and see every communication that has happened. In the COVID era, it is also more important that we have to ask the patient positively that whether you have cough, whether you have breathlessness, whether you have diarrhea, and all symptoms that the government has recorded for COVID-related screening. Again, a template which forms on the text-based app is sent to the patient, and the patient has to record and say that no, he does not have these symptoms. That makes you safer, that you're not within the viability or liability to report it to the government that the current symptomatology is not of COVID, but of the primary disease itself. In rheumatology, I come across these problems because patients have interstitial lung disease, patients have inflammatory bowel disease, and I have to differentiate whether this is a new onset symptom or an old symptom. And that is why confirmation from the patient is important. Ultimately, it does come down to your own clinical perspective. It does go down to your own clinical judgment. But getting yourself legally and practically sound is more better. Thank you. I think, and lastly, I would sign off that today we are discussing as if telemedicine is future, or so we are discussing that telemedicine is present. I would like to end up saying that telemedicine is already past. We have missed the bandwagon. We better jump on it as early as possible. Thank you.
Thank you,
Dr. Very well said, Nachiket. Absolutely. You summed it up very well that it has already been there. Only thing is now we are really, we are rekindling it.
Absolutely. Yes. And in fact, as a medical practitioner, we need to understand that now no longer clinical medicine is an exclusive science. Telemedicine is an extension of clinical medicine. Which we have to imbibe in our psyche, that it is good to do a telemedicine. It is not wrong to ask money for telemedicine. It is not wrong if we are taking care of the legal provisions to continue consultation in telemedicine.
I would just add that whatever Nachiket said, in Marathi, I can just sum it up, that he already hota, ata tela Raja Manyata
Midali. That's true.
Absolutely. Excellent. Very well covered. Thank you so much for all those insights. One quick question I want to ask, Dr. Nachiket and Dr. Girija Vag. Most of the doctors sometimes feel that they have a reluctance from patients in accepting this new mode of communication and advice, and obviously the ability to pay for it. So how have you been able to convert your patients and establish your telemedicine practice? And second thing, how do you plan to grow it? So I'll offer it first to Dr. Girija Vag, and then Dr. Nachiket, you can also add your views. Ma'am, we can't hear you. You're on mute. Ma'am, you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. So basically, it was the Pune traffic which made me do this in the prime thing. And then later on, I realized that my patients started feeling comfortable doing that. Most importantly, however, there are certain timelines when the patient has to be face-to-face, and then we both on sides agree. As Dr. Nachiket very rightly said, it's important that the patient answers a few questions. And I have gone ahead and made some templates. You know, when a patient says, I'm having irregular menses, then I have a set of list of checklists which I send to her. And then she has to answer those questions. Do you have any of these? I also ask about family history, especially for a first time consultation. And then I insist in my chat, I write that it is important that we check you. And then I write my prescription within the framework that has been mentioned. After I have answered this question, Vinita, I also want to ask a few questions to the medical legal experts with your permission, of course. I continue with my answer. And how do I propose to improvise on this? Is again, as Dilip said, I can't use this particular DR Prax as a modality of publicizing my practice, but I consider it as a mode of reaching out to my patients and for them to be, for me being available for them 24/7. So that is how I look at it as an asset. And I don't get bothered by their questions. They can ask them to me anytime.
Absolutely, Girija, you are absolutely right.
One thing, if I may add, am I audible?
You are.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So one thing I'll add that telemedicine is a part which entails three different things. It is health education, it is counseling, and it is prescribing medicine. So there are three different things. So when madam is giving these templates, it is a part of health education because they get educated what is happening, what is, you know, wrong or, you know, material to read. When you are discussing something, there is also counseling part involved. And then the third thing is the prescription part. Unfortunately, what happens is every time we discuss, we only discuss about diagnosis and prescription. But another advantages of counseling and advantages of health education are also there with telemedicine. So, you know, even those things we need to discuss. Now, as far as the consent thing which Nachiket asked, the thing is guidelines will always give you a bare minimum that needs to be done. You can always improve upon it. Now, how do we improve upon it? These are the guidelines or the improvements come from, actually cases which have occurred or something which has gone wrong, which is not acceptable codes. So what I quoted is bare minimum. You can definitely add another template to it. You can definitely add. So if there's an implicit consent, you can definitely add to that consent and make another template. But these are bare minimum guidelines that we have to follow. So I just, discussed bare minimum guidelines. Now, important things, yes. Now again, so from rheumatology practice or from physician practice, very important thing is 6 months is the top may upper limit. Afterwards, you have to see the patient in person. So these are some small things or the category of drugs which they are prescribing.
So I think someday later, even the societies like FOCSI will have to come out with their guidelines on teleconsultation, and every society will have to then chip in and then add to the guidelines that are already come from the MCI. So that we have GCPR guidelines for all sorts of situations. So we need to have good practice guidelines for teleconsultation also. And that's exactly what I said. I mean, Girija has been doing some innovative work. Like at one click of button, she is taking the history from the patient. So these are the innovations which is going to help us. If we are going to talk financially, this is going to help us increase our practice from 10% of the OPD cash flow to easily. I'm sure Girija and Nachiket must be drawing almost about 25% of the OPD practice, which otherwise we are losing on doing teleconsultation free of charge with our patients. So,
nahi re, Dilip, face to face jada hai, don't worry.
One more thing. Is there any psychiatrist sitting here in the audience? I just wanted to ask. A lot of advocacy is going to be required when it comes to psychotropic drugs. I mean, there are many a psychiatrist friends of mine who I know that they feel that it is sometimes difficult for these patients to follow up with them every 15 days to take the add-on on the psychotropic drug. So I think the psychiatry association will have to do a lot of advocacy with the MCI to see to it that certain psychotropic drugs should be allowed only to the psychiatrist or something of that sort has to come. I mean, you can't be keeping the psychiatrist away from this telemedicine. In fact, psychiatrists have to come into the consultation because now mental health is going to come up in a big way. Yes, Nachiket wants to say that.
Definitely. And we do have psychologists. In fact, last week we had an example
for psychiatrists, I'll just add that they have to also go through the Mental Health Care Act. I mean, I don't want to divert from the topic, but the new Mental Health Care Act which has come it's very stringent. It is like PCP NDT for us. So if psychiatrists are there, please, request all of you to go through it. And I don't want to divert, so let's continue with this discussion.
So, thank you very much.
Vinita Nachiket wants to say something.
Yes, sir. So, can you go ahead, Dr. Nachiket? Just give your views quickly. Dr. Nachiket, yes.
Yeah, two aspects. How did I channelize patients on my telemedicine consultations? One is you close all other options of communications. No telephone calls, no WhatsApp, get off WhatsApp completely, get off Facebook, get off your social communication websites.
Your family might suffer, whatever that may be. But if you have only one mode of communication that you're going to express, there's no way other than the patient has to. And the law gives you right to maintain your mode of communication. Two, if you have an EMR, if you have a register of all your patients with your numbers, most doctor practice and most telemedicine have ready to give their bulk SMSs. And that is not advertisement, because it is reaching out to your own patients. You're not trying to reach out to a new clientele. And three, about psychiatric medicines, because many of times in fibromyalgia or some neuropsychiatric manifestations of connective tissue disorders, again, if Dr. Machme could correct me, if a patient is already on a medication, if a patient is already on a medication and you are going to extend it, that comes into category B, which is allowed by a video, text and audio consultation. Any new starting of a Schedule X or Schedule O drug is what is not allowed. But something which is ongoing can be continued.
Thank you, sir. Yes. Thank you. That's this thing. I'll quickly, in the interest of time, I'll quickly try to cover the Dr. Prax platform. We're already half an hour overboard, so I apologize for the spillover. It was also due to the technical difficulty we had initially. So we'll quickly go through the Dr. Prax demo, and then we will open up for questions. If there are a lot of questions that I'm seeing in the chat sessions, we'll quickly have the experts that are there to go through those. I have an 8-minute video and a quick view into our Dr. Prax web, and that should take a couple of minutes. And then we will cover question and answers for 10 minutes. So it's going to take 20 minutes more. I apologize for the spillover, but we'll quickly cover that. Let me know if you can see my screen.
Yes.
We can see it.
App and desktop have been designed for simplicity. It covers each aspect of doctor-patient engagement journey, which is acquiring patient, smart OPD, appointment management, and most importantly, remote consultation. You can download the app from Google Play Store and Apple App Store. After downloading, select you are a doctor, enter your number and name, verify your number, and proceed. Now, first thing to do is complete your profile detail. Click on the profile icon in the top right corner. Fill up personal details, professional, clinic, and payment detail. Enter your medical registration number in professional detail. You will be requested to submit a medical certificate after you are onboarded by our verification team. Click on the payment detail. Click on the bank account detail. Here you can enter the bank detail where you want to get your consultation fees in. Click on the consultation charges. You can enter consultation chat and audio call charges here. If you don't enter it manually while communicating with the patient, amount will be get picked up from here by default. Now click on the clock icon in the top right corner. There are two options, received and pending. Click on the received one. You'll be able to see which patients has paid you and for what, like consultation or chat or audio call. Now click on the pending one. You'll be able to see the patient who haven't paid you yet and for what. Now going back to the profile screen. If you have any query, suggestion, and wants to connect with us, click on the contact us. You can directly write an email to us from here and directly call us. Now, to the home screen. Important things are how to invite your patient. How will your patients know that you are available on Dr. Prax for online consultation? That's one. Second is how to communicate with your patient, how to write a prescription, generate a prescription, and then how to charge them upfrontly and how to manage the payments. And third is OPD and appointment management. Now, how to invite your patient? Click on the invite icon in the middle at the top side. You can search patient from the search patient if they have already downloaded Dr. Prax. If you have your patient's contact saved in your phone, click on the invite from contacts. Type your patient's name here, which phone you have saved. Click on the patient's name. Click on send invite. Patient will receive the details. Now, if you want
it has got आणि नुसतं ते कारण नाही, बाकी लोक म्हणजे
Vinita, you've been muted.
Yes, I'll just go ahead. I have unmuted myself.
You can just click on copy to clipboard and copy this message. Now, going back to the home screen, how to communicate with your patient. Now, I'm clicking here at one patient name. If I want to write anything to patient, when I write it, it will ask me, when I click on the enter button, it will ask me whether I want to charge this patient for this chat. It is completely on doctor. It is completely in doctor's hand or decide whether they want to charge this patient while initiating the conversation or maybe they want to charge later on. For now, I'm clicking on no. If doctor wants to charge later on, they can just click on this Indian rupee icon next to the patient name. Enter the amount for chat and confirm the amount. And just patient will receive the invoice for that amount. And till the time the patient doesn't pay that amount, patient will not be able to send any message to you or communicate with you. Now, how to write a prescription? Click on the plus icon at the bottom right corner. Click on the medical advice. Here you are able to see gallery, camera, documents, video, etc. If you want to send any report, anything from camera and gallery, you can just send it from here. Now to generate a prescription, click on medical advice. Enter the consultation charges here. You can write prescription, edit old prescription, and take a photo of hard copy of prescription directly. Now click on the write prescription. After filling up all the details, you will be able to sign here digitally. Now click on continue, sign, click on continue. Patient will receive the prescription along with the invoice of consultation charges you enter here. Now I am putting it zero. Confirm. Till the time patient don't pay for that invoice, she will not be able to access the prescription. Now, how to see your appointment and manage your appointment? Click on the appointment icon at the bottom right corner. Click on the add schedule. Here you can add your weekday schedule from time to two time, time interval for each slot and patients per slot. After you add your schedule here, patient will be able to see availability for that particular schedule and they can book your appointment directly from the patient app itself. Now click on the manage schedule. If for any particular day you are not available for some reason, you can block that particular day so that patient will not be able to book your appointment for that particular day. And if any appointments are already there for that day and if you block that day, patient will receive a cancellation message. Now to see my appointments, click on my appointment. You will be able to see your appointments for that particular day here. If you want to see it for another day, click on the date and select the date whichever you want to see the appointment for. And now you'll be able to see for the appointment for the fifth day. Now there is no appointment for the fifth. Now going back to this second name, this is the appointment. Now if doctor wants to cancel the appointment, they can click on the cancel appointment and just confirm the appointment cancellation. So that appointments will get cancelled and patient will receive a cancellation message for the appointment cancellation. This appointment view can also be seen from the OPD icon in the middle at the home screen at the bottom side, OPD. Now go to my chats. This is the home screen. If you are busy in your personal schedule or something, or for some reason you will not be able to respond to your patients immediately, there is one provision. If you can see a button below the profile icon, that is online and offline button. Click on the online, offline button. Whenever you are available, you can make it online. And whenever you are not available, you can just make it offline. Now your availability status is changed to offline. If you want to make it online, you can just make it online with one click. Now to the next thing, that's the call log. You will be able to see your all call details here. Like your patient call conversation details here. and schedule. This is a medico-legal compliant platform to connect with your patient very easily.
Vinita, you have to share the presentation.
Yes, this is very useful to the doctors with the current situation to consult your patients remotely, to manage your patients remotely, and this is very helpful. Thank you so much. I would recommend all doctors to use Dr. Prax for the remote consultation platform, and also it has a very nice user-friendly web platform. I would urge you to look at web platform also through the demo. Thank you.
So this was our platform. I'll quickly go through the web platform so you get a sense of what we are offering on the web as well. So as soon as you register onto Dr. Prax, you are able, you also have access to the web platform. It's through the same phone number and OTP login that you use for your mobile is what you use to sign in into the Dr. Prax web platform. You have to go to www.drprax.com. In this corner, there is a login button. You click on here, and once you log in, you are able to get onto the web platform. Now, on the web platform, you have the ability to see your OPD queue. You can see your patients list. You can book appointments. You can see your past invoices, and you can also manage your schedule. So these are the functionalities that's available. I'll quickly go through a patient list and how you can create a prescription for a patient. So you can search for a patient, you pick up a patient, and you can see all his previous prescriptions. So this was a prescription that you had generated for the patient in the past. You can see any old reports that are there or any of the invoices that you had generated for this patient. So this was a past invoice. You can see those. Similarly, as I said, you can see previous reports as well. If you want to generate a prescription from the patient, you can go ahead and do it. You can complain spondyloarthritis. You can come up with a diagnosis. You enter the vital parameters. This is an intelligent drug search. So this gets built as and when you enter the drugs. And it gets pre-filled depending on your past prescription. So you don't need to enter these details again and again. If that's a drug that you've prescribed before, it gets pre-filled and it is available for you. So it really helps you generate a prescription very fast. So you add the drugs, you can add additional drugs, you can change and you can add additional drugs and keep adding them to the list. You can delete and you can modify. We are doing the modify option, but you can delete it and add new drugs as well. There's a capability for you to enter any additional medical advice or follow-ups. And then you sign in. And once you sign in, you confirm the signature and go ahead and confirm your prescription. So your prescription gets generated in an MCI approved format and it gets sent to the patient. And the patient will have to make a payment before they can see the prescription. So that way your payment is assured. I'll quickly go through some of the services that we are offering on the Dr. Prax engagement platform. I'll quickly go through those. So you can manage your appointments. You can create prescription. You can see patient records, a past history, of course. You can consult remotely. We have a separate receptionist app and an integrated payment gateway. It's a safe PCI approved payment gateway. So, it is secure for you as well as your patient. You saw the access from the web. And most importantly, it's approved by IMA Pune. It's medico-legally compliant and it ensures privacy and security for both you and your patient. We also have a Dr. Prax Doctor Success Team. This has been created so that the platform is not just easy for you to use, but also for your patients. We help you onboard your patients so they can easily consult with you. So there will be an account manager that will be assigned to every doctor who onboards our platform. They will connect with you. They will help you through onboarding your patients. If you give them a list, they can onboard or they can guide you through the app in terms of how to onboard new patients. If you generate any prescription or you have any charges for chats or any audio consultations, the patient has to pay in advance. That's coming up next. Audio and video consultations are coming up. But to book an appointment for an audio consultation, the patient has to pay in advance. So that way your payment is insured. But in case for a prescription, if a patient doesn't pay or they are facing any challenges, our team follows up with them and ensures that your payment comes in. So this is a back-end work that keeps happening once you're on the platform. We provide, obviously, technical support anytime, 24/7. We're available to help you and your patients with any challenges you may face. We stay connected with you. As I said, an account manager is assigned who stays connected with you. So if you have any new requirements, you have any new suggestions, we take those down. And if they are relevant to a vast majority of our doctors, we add them to our roadmap and ensure that they are addressed in future. We also are now providing a consolidated monthly payment statement. So whatever payments you have received through your patients, you're assured that these are the payments you've received and they have been credited to your bank account. So that's the overall structure. So we ensure that it is successful for you. From here, I would like to pass it on for question and answers. And there are a lot of people who have questions for our legal team. So please go ahead and ask them, and we would try to have them addressed as much as early as possible. So there were a lot of questions on chat. I'll quickly go through those, and I would request our experts to answer them. So I think there was one important question on the medico-legal safety and consent. I'll just quickly go through those questions. So there's a question from Dr. Rohini Deshpande. We have to become a member of Indian Telemedicine Association. So Dr. Matsue, can you answer that? Is that a requirement?
Telemedicine membership of Telemedicine Association? No. The Board of Governors have very clearly said at for the present time, any registered medical practitioner can use telemedicine. But later on, they are going to get down with a small course, which will be an online course. And only those RMPs who do the online course will be allowed to do telemedicine practice in the future. Now, this course will, it will encompass training about telemedicine and all the rules and everything which all the guidelines which the doctor should know. But presently, you are only required to be a RMP to practice telemedicine.
And Manish, the course is going to start as late as 3 years from today. So there is a lot of time.
Yeah, so at present, any RMP, so all of us, thank you, Rohini madam, for that question, but we definitely can.
Okay, excellent. There is a question by Swayam Clinic. Is surgical consultation, is that okay?
Consultation is okay. See, consult, so that is why I said there are three parts to it. First is health education, second is counseling. And third is consultation, which involves history taking, examination also you can do through video, use of video, and then give your prescription. So these are three different parts or three different arms of telemedicine that we can use. So consultation definitely, but the exclusion very clearly mentions that you cannot send a surgical video to another RMP or start a video through one of the video channels and look at the video and start operating. That is absolutely unknown.
So, in fact, they are very specific in mentioning that use of digital media, digital technology for remote surgeries is not allowed. So, which yes. Does that mean, Manish, that robotic surgeries at this moment of time is not allowed? I mean, this is one thing.
Yes. So,
when I read that, it implied as if using digital medium for doing surgeries, remote surgeries is not allowed.
Is not allowed. So
means that robotic is not allowed.
Yes. So if you go by the clear interpretation as of now, robotics are not allowed.
So a lot of advocacy is still need to be done. I mean, these guidelines have come in a hurry. So what is needed now from different societies to come out with guidelines and do advocacy with this Board of Governors? They have done their job a little in a hurry. I can understand that, and there are bound to be some lacunae in the guidelines also, but we'll have to.
They have already mentioned clearly that there will be repeated amendments and further upkeeping, because obviously they have come in an absolute flash. that they started, right. I mean, submitted to the government on 23rd, 24th, it got submitted, and 25th, they are already accepting and coming out with a gazette notification. So it is absolutely in a hurry. But they have also mentioned clearly that there will be further updates and further amendments.
And that's the reason why there is a need for guidelines from our side and advocacy. Like IMA can take it up, create some guidelines and start.
I think two more things to be added. One is that robotic surgery, when a person is performing within his own limits, I mean, within his own hospital, that's okay. But you are giving advice from somebody from sitting over here and telephoning somebody in Ratnagiri and Hyderabad that you do this way is not allowed.
And so sir, for time being, in this pandemic, they are given the guidelines. They will change the guidelines afterwards.
No, these guidelines are not restricted only for pandemic. They are given generalized guidelines.
Laurangi sir, I want to ask you ki how come it is not allowed? Manje, what is the point if somebody is asking you for a consultation that I am stuck in this, there's an office at the corporate end?
Madam, if you are stuck in a particular thing as an emergency, everything is allowed. Point is that somebody is initiating the surgery under your advice, the robotic surgery being run remotely, that is not permitted. And that will never be allowed.
So as I said, there is patient to RMP, RMP to RMP, RMP to healthcare worker, and RMP to caregiver. So there are different types of telecommunication. And at the present time, I think more clarity is only if the patient calls you and then you are doing the consultation, more clarity on this one issue. And RMP calling another RMP, especially the pathologist or, the radiologist. One question which I think I saw, how the pharmacist will give medicine. I think the pharmacist can give medicine because you can take the prescription and you can pass on the prescription via email or WhatsApp. Or, you can pass that email through net. So then the pharmacist will have one copy and can give it to the...
My patients are taking a printout. I mean,
Yes, you can definitely.
Even my patients are taking a printout. And today, basically, I feel that when we are defining these rules, we have to be all inclusive and little lax. We cannot be very, ye nahi karna, wo nahi karna kinds, because that is the only way in which now patients can access, and this pandemic is going to last us in this particular way for nearly a year. So therefore, sometimes you have to be very, very inclusive, because if at one end we are saying that O&Ms can go and take blood pressures at home, why can't we be a little more tolerant and understanding and in acceptance and not putting everything under medical legally a chalega kya nahi chalega? There has to be, some, because technology is taking this thing so far away. Why medicine is not getting included into this? It is important. And we will have to, therefore, while we are making laws, we will have to be very, very careful and make this as inclusive as possible.
Dr. Matsue, does the downloading Dr. Prax app implied consent?
Yes. So implied consent, if the patient gives you a call, then it's like a patient coming to your OPD. So once the patient comes to your OPD, there's an implied consent for history taking, examination, and non-invasive treatment. For invasive treatment, you definitely require another consent. So similarly, if the patient calls you, so it's a call from through one of these media, if the call is from the patient to a doctor, there's an implied consent for history taking, examination, getting investigations done, and this
lady. To be abundantly cautious, what Dr. Prax has done is, Dr. Navrange has designed the disclaimers for us, and the consent, like we download any app, while downloading an app, we do consent to use of the phone, to use of our contact. Similarly, when the patient is downloading this Dr. Prax app, they are already giving a consent to use this platform for online consultation. So it's a consent that has been already taken.
Yeah, good. Well, that's the biggest advantage of probably having this app, is if the patient has downloaded it and initiates even one word consultation, you can directly initiate the consent.
So the question, another question which Nachiket, you asked, was that if you are giving the idea to the patient, see, that is, you are giving information to the patient to use. Once the patient initiates, it is the patient who has initiated. It is the information that you have given, see, so-and-so is available. So that is why the guidelines also say if the patient can come
physically, then the patient should come physically, not a problem. You are just telling this is one of the modes and you are giving information, that is dissemination of information, and then the patient uses it, there's no problem.
Only the misconduct, under the misconduct, they say you cannot force a patient to use the platform. All that you are,
so
you cannot say that I'm
coming, like, so the decision patient has made.
And lastly, again, about the category O, if a patient is on category O medications already on regular follow-up, does it become a category B medicine if he has logged on to your app?
No, sir. The category of medicines remain the fortunate thing for OBGYN practice is whatever consultations and prescriptions we give, especially general OBGYN practice, all of them are category O drugs. So I don't see much of a problem coming for a obstetrician or a gyn. The issues come only for, you know, people where the consultation becomes chronic. And I know the psychiatry thing is a important thing. And when it becomes chronic, then you have a problem. So what they call as refill or add-on medicines.
Then like antihypertensive, insulin, then this chemotherapy, the oncologist, they have to give medicines for their symptoms after having taken a chemotherapy cycle. When the patient goes on, patient comes out with a lot of symptoms. So they have to treat them. So these will be add-on drugs,
precise. The most common complaint that a patient comes to a doctor is pain across specialties, across the world, across any clinic.
Correct.
So for pain, if patient has already been prescribed tramadol, which becomes a Schedule H drug, can it be continued on Dr. Prax because the patient has already been on?
So again, this is a...
Okay, so...
Manish.
So as an add-on, see, so the guidelines do not give you the names of all the drugs.
Yep.
The list is not
exhausted. Point number one.
At this moment of
explicit exception is made for Schedule X drugs. Otherwise, all the drugs are not there. So they are saying that as an add-on or as a refill. So this will be a refill drug because the patient is already on that drug. You can definitely give. That's not a problem. Absolutely. All the drugs are just guidelines. See, whatever I discussed with bare minimum. And why I don't put them in category O, A and B? Because they are some different categories other than the category of drugs that we study.
Absolutely.
Yeah. There's also a question from Dr. Ganpure. If it will be covered only until the lockdown or even after the lockdown, distance practices will be allowed?
This is not related to lockdown. It will continue. In fact, after lockdown, I think there will be few changes. Like, you know, so many suggestions will go. And I hope, you know, people like Dr. Navrange sir and, you know, Dr. Gupte sir, all senior people will be taken into consideration while draft. At least if they want to draft rules for state-wise, so for our state, IMA president will be taken into, you know, Dr. Bondwe is there, and so many senior people who have feedback from common people, and then we can have our own, nicely drafted guidelines. For the only thing is that whenever these guidelines or whenever any acts or whenever any bills, anything is there, and a doctor or somebody from the healthcare is a part of it, I'm not divulging from the topic. That person has to be up on Marathi tek shabda vaparto sajag. And is to be very alert in, you know, giving his opinions. Otherwise, we don't want, again, a PCP NDT or, you know, so many such situations. So that person has to be sajag. He has to understand what kind of, you know, inputs that person is giving. So ART, surrogacy, these are all, you know, unfortunately, where we have burnt our hands, fingers, head, hair, everything.
So I think we've had a very, very interesting discussion. We've already overspilled by about an hour. And I'm thankful to all the people who have stayed back and with us. There are a whole lot of questions. We will record those. And with Dr. Navrange, Dr. Matsve, Dr. Valke, in getting answers for these and circulating answers for those questions back again.
Vinita, yeah. Can I conclude? I have a nice sentence for you.
Fantastic. Please go ahead, sir.
So, telemedicine, if you can communicate, why commute?
Very good. Awesome. Very good. Yeah.
Don't commute when you can communicate. Use telemedicine.
Yes.
Great.
Fantastic. And it's going to stay. It's going to stay. It's going to increase, widen the scope.
Excellent. Very well summarized. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to express my my deep gratitude to Dr. Navrange, Dr. Arati Nimkar, Dr. Mage, Dr. Nachiket, Dr. Girijwag, and of course, Dr. Walke. Thank you all so much for your dedicated time. It has been a very informative and very helpful session. And I want to apologize for some of the glitches we had in the beginning. I assure you that we'll do this next time over a better platform, and it would be much better conducted. This is a learning for us as well. Thank you all once again.
Thank you.
Appreciate you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.